West Hartford Community Television.
You're watching West Hartford Community Television.
You're watching West Hartford Community Television. Yay!
For the community, by the community.
And you're watching Life and Style with Sarah. On tonight's show, Maureen Haisley-Jones, the English lady, is joining me to talk about how to garden organically. Maureen, thank you so much for joining me.
It's a pleasure, Sarah. Absolutely a pleasure. I'm thrilled to be here in April. I mean, the spring bulbs are all coming through, and the buds are on the trees. And can you smell the earth waking up?
Is that a wonderful smell?
Oh, it's a marvelous smell.
It's the smell of spring, isn't
it? Yes, yes, it is.
I love that smell.
But we need to keep it so that smell is non-toxic.
Okay.
meaning no chemicals, no herbicides, and no pesticides.
Okay.
So that we can, we can heal our planet, heal the earth, and grow wonderful, healthy, disease-resistant plants. And the way to do that is from the ground up.
So yes. Let's say you've been gardening traditionally, not necessarily minus chemicals and things, and how do you make that transition to getting your soil to a good place organically?
Well,
process, or
it is. It will take time, mm-hmm. And one of the things you can do, for instance, if you have a farm somewhere in your area, you can ask the farmer if he will deliver to you a nice big pile of manure. A lot of times on the farms, there's some aged manure as well. Mm-hmm. But if he also, you also get some fresh manure, you would have to leave that on your property. Hide it in a corner behind a shed or a garage or something, so that the chemicals, which probably they've been using, the farmers, I would say, so that the chemicals, the herbicides and pesticides, will leach out within a year.
So it takes a year to get
it
them
takes
out.
A year. However, in the meantime, though, the thing is to start now, which is to replenish and nourish that soil with organic, substance. It can be compost if you have a compost pile, and if you don't, if you email me, maureen@theenglishlady.com, I will send you a whole article that I wrote on composting.
On how to compost.
And in the meantime, though, use from the garden center, bags and bags and bags of aged manure, because you need to build the soil. The soil has been completely leached out of any kind of structure, and so we need to put structure back into the soil, and the manure too, with the bacteria, mm-hmm. Will work with the microorganisms in the soil to really make it into a nourishing situation.
Do you need to, when you put the manure out, do you do it like you would do mulch, or do you have to dig it in around your plants, and is April too soon to start digging around?
It is a little, what you can do is, first of all, in April, you can re-edge the garden. That'll give you something to do. Get you moving, because, you need to be in shape, and many of us have been couch potatoes through the winter.
Yeah. And the winter chubs, as
exactly,
my father-in-law calls
exactly,
them.
Exactly. and in the meantime, make sure you do your stretching before you go out in the garden, and take plenty of water so you keep, dehydrated, because even on a somewhat cool spring day, you'll soon work up a sweat, and you're losing liquid. So make sure you're hydrated, and more so too, protect your skin. With a natural sun product. There are plenty of natural sun products you can get from all over the place. In fact, if folks want to go on to the English Lady. .com/blog, our eco shop is up with all kinds of wonderful products, whether it's for the garden or for cleaning the house.
Oh, wow, really?
Yeah, natural products, Seaside Naturals.
Nice.
And also for the skin.
Hmm.
You know, so that you
right.
know.
Well, yes, and if you're gardening, you do need to protect your
absolutely,
skin.
Absolutely, absolutely. Mm-hmm. And too, to do it with protection, too. You know, there are a lot of, you know, Lyme disease
yes.
thoughts around, too. So when you're out among, you know, high weeds or grass, high grass, etc., to wear a long sleeve a shirt, you know, a light-colored one, mm-hmm. so you could tell any of those little devils on there too.
Right,
and
there
then check
are
yourself.
A lot in
yes,
this area.
Yes, there are. Mm-hmm. And check yourself when you come in, and have somebody, you know, check the back of you and check your hair, etc. Too. But where were we? We were.
So,
oh,
do you dig in the manure
right.
this early, or do you just lay it like mulch? What do you
lay
do?
It? You would lay it on the soil for now, because okay. if you dig around your plants too mm-hmm. soon, you know, if the ground is still rather cold and wet, mm-hmm. You can disturb the roots of your plants. So in the meantime, you know, put on, you know, a nice layer of manure, like 2 or 3 inches at least.
Wow.
All over every single, you know, border, under the trees, the shrubs, and all around your perennials, etc. Too, work some into your container pots too,
okay.
so that you've got a good nourishing situation there as well. And you know, April showers, right? Bring May flowers,
right.
etc. So the rain will help,
work
you know,
it.
That work that into the soil. What I would suggest too, though, is on a non-windy day, mm-hmm. you would take, say you've got covering on roses, like a rose cone, or on some small shrubs evergreens that you may have planted mm-hmm. last fall. You would take gently take off those coverings from around the from around those shrubs,
mm-hmm.
except on an exposed slope. You know, where you know that even though it's April, there might be a nasty wind that still may come. So you may want to wait until the beginning of May, you know, to take those covers off there.
Right.
Because, Sarah, wind can be more of a problem than cold. Because what the wind does, it can dry out a plant and really shock it and cause it to bite the dust on you.
Now, so if that has happened, is it possible to just cut off the damaged part, or do you need, or is it really just going to get right down into the roots and kill the plant?
No, it won't, love. It will, you can cut off the damaged part. In fact, in April, that's a good time to do that before the new growth starts.
Okay.
Because if you go in and you cut off the damaged part, the new growth will hide any of those little stubs where you've had to cut off as well. And, you know, so you should be all right there.
But so I'm going to admit that I have not covered anything in my yard, and I do have some rose bushes that
yes.
are fairly new, and mm-hmm. I had intended to cover them, and time went and I never
right,
did.
Right.
So April, I should look and see, you know, how would I know what to cut off? Is it black? Is it obvious what's dead?
Yes, yes. Well, actually, on evergreens, because even though it's evergreen,
mm-hmm.
it's not always evergreen, because just like the deciduous trees, you know, that lose their leaves in the fall, the evergreen shrubs, they have got older growth in there that's just died off.
Yes.
It's very natural.
Mm-hmm.
So you go in there, for instance, you know, in a shrub or whatever, and you kind of shake it with your hands, and a lot of the, you know, the brown will just fall off
mm-hmm.
for you.
Okay.
So, but if a evergreen is really dead, it would be brown all over.
All over.
Yes.
Not just, yeah.
Right.
We had installed some white pines. I think they were white pine, but long-needled. Pines.
Yes. Yeah. White pines. Yes.
Actually, I don't think they were white. I can't remember the specific name. But anyway,
right.
the long-needled pines, and we love this. It's a border. It provides privacy. And then the first fall we had them in, a whole bunch of needles turned brown, and we thought, oh, it's dying. Oh no! You know,
right.
we just installed these plants, but it's exactly what you said was
yes.
happening. The
yes.
old growth was dying.
Right.
You know, shake them off.
Right.
And the new stuff
mm-hmm.
comes in. So. Don't panic if you have some brown needles.
No, don't panic. And seeing we're talking a little bit about evergreens now. You can plant evergreens in the spring, obviously, because many of them are shallow rooted. So it needs to have time to really have those roots go into the earth and get established. If you plant them in the spring, they will establish nicely for you. But don't plant them, say you say, here we come in September, I want to plant some arborvitae or some boxwood or something. Don't go beyond September, because otherwise those roots won't have had time to establish and you could lose the plant.
Okay.
So September is the cutoff spot to do with them. You know, the evergreens.
Okay.
And the other thing, you know, you were talking about your roses. You said
almost new. I put them in the beginning of last summer.
Okay.
So they had plenty of time to get, and they did well, but I didn't
cover
them.
Good.
So how will I know what
to put off? Say, well, the first year, mm-hmm. you do not prune the roses.
Okay.
You leave them that first year, unless they become really have they gone out of sight to do with becoming straggly or too big. Okay. So and you did plant them last early
yeah, so
last
yes. Been in almost a year.
They've been in almost a year. What I do is I prune the English way, which is I prune in October, early October, which means I take off a lot of the, the first two to 3 feet of growth.
Okay.
Just so that they don't wave around in the wind, you know, or get battered about in the wind, that top growth, which can, you know, if the wind's really heavy and you've got it, it would be like a, like a parachute. It would really, it could, you could lose the whole plant, it could just snap off if it's really grown large. But the other thing to do is in April, end of April, you then prune your roses all the way down to about a foot to a foot and a half from the ground.
Really?
If you do that, what you're doing, it's like when you get a haircut, your hair really seems to grow nice and full, doesn't it? So that's what you would do.
All roses? Any type?
Any of the roses, yes, except for what I call climbing roses. There actually is no such thing as a climbing rose.
Really?
They are shrub roses that
let go,
and they will climb up anything.
Okay.
In fact, a wonderful combination is roses and clematis. You know, they really do well. But you know, I think maybe maybe we can do that in another program.
Yeah.
I'm thinking that we should go back to the soil a little bit.
Yes, let's. We got off topic.
So we put our manure down.
We put our manure down,
that wonderful stuff.
Yes.
As I always say, manure like a fine wine gets better with age, just like the English lady. So. And who needs
wine, the English lady, and manure all in one sentence?
Great stuff. As I say, who needs Claritin when you can just clear your nostrils with a manure, right?
There you go.
And so you put down, you know, your manure, and you'll start to build up the structure.
Okay.
And you don't just put manure down either, Sarah, in spring. It would be spring, summer, and fall.
The same amount, another 2 inches.
Oh yeah, because what you're doing, for instance, in spring, you are really trying to nourish that bed because it's going to be growing those wonderful plants. Soil is not just a medium that holds plants up. Soil is the main character in the play, and then again about July, when a lot of the goodness has been used from the soil. Because you've been growing things. Mm-hmm. And then again in October, so that over the winter, when the manure does not have to work with making bloom and foliage, it's going down to help any root systems, and also working with the frost over the winter to keep on building that soil.
Okay.
It's been so neglected. It really has. It's been very neglected.
Yeah.
And
abused with the chemicals.
Oh.
Yeah.
Chemicals, they kill the earthworms. And earthworms are marvelous little guys there. You know, some of my best friends are earthworms. They're down in the soil there. Their castings, their weight in, what they do is they drop their weight in castings every day. And the castings help again with the microorganisms. They help to aerate the soil and they help with drainage, particularly when you've got a clay soil.
Right, which I know in my yard, my soil is very clay.
Right.
A lot of clay in my soil.
Mm-hmm. So any of the soils, whether it's sand, whether it's clay, or whether it's, you know, a good loam, all of it needs the manure, though. Mm-hmm. You just keep on doing it. If you do that, actually, you won't need fertilizer. Although, if you do want to put some fertilizer mm-hmm. on, you can make sure that when you read on the bag in the garden center that it should have bone meal, blood meal, seaweed emulsion, and natural grains. That's a good organic fertilizer.
So you can use that for food if you.
Yes, but the thing is, it's much better to under-fertilize than over-fertilize. But if you see that your plants are growing wonderfully, and you certainly don't fertilize first thing in the spring.
Yeah.
You don't fertilize, for instance, you would fertilize your perennials when they're about 6 inches out of the ground. Then you could add a little, fertilizer. And the other thing to do is weeds are coming up now. I see them in April. April. Where we are.
Yeah.
They've started already, love. And so, you know, quite often what I do when I get home from a job site is I put my bag by the kitchen door and I go and I'm plucking a few weeds, mm-hmm. you know, so that they don't get a head start on me.
Right, they don't spread.
Exactly, especially the ones with runners.
Yes.
And so you go and you get those. And the other thing to do is to put down an organic pre-emergent for weed control.
Okay.
And the one that we use in our company is called Cock-a-Doodle-Doo.
Okay, yeah, I've seen that.
Yes, yes, mm-hmm. you can get it in a lot of mm-hmm. the garden centers. And it's a corn gluten-based product, and it smells a little strong, but that smell goes away in, within 12 hours.
Okay.
And, that's what you would do. The other thing, too, is, and you don't mulch, actually, too, until the ground starts to warm up, which would be more like towards the end of May.
So on top of the manure, you would actually mulch.
You'd put down the weed pre-emergent, uh-huh. and it's yellow. You know, you can't miss it. And then you would mulch later on. You know, you'll mm-hmm. mulch when May comes around. The ground will have warmed up a little bit. Don't use that red mulch. That awful.
It's
terrible.
Like that.
It's got chemical in it.
Right.
Use a fine bark mulch, mm-hmm. A nice ground fine bark mulch. And certainly, and I'm saying to all of the folks out there, mm-hmm. do not use the cocoa mulch, which you can get, because it's poisonous.
Okay.
And it's been known to cause seizures in dogs and cats.
Oh.
Because they're attracted by the chocolate smell.
So they start to eat anything.
Exactly, exactly.
Right.
And not only that, I mean, children will too. You know, it's amazing what little ones
are
in their mouths.
Mm-hmm.
It causes seizures in dogs and cats, and mm-hmm. they can be dead within no time at all. So
I'm going to stop you for just a minute, because we have some pictures of the types of gardens. You have a very English garden feel. So we're going to pop in a picture of your house with the garden
right.
in front of it. And now this, your gardens are all organically, treated and with the manure, and they're just beautiful.
Well, I will say this too, to do with my garden. Because I live down on the shore, mm-hmm. it's sand.
Yes, okay.
Wonderful for drainage, but has no nutrition value at all.
Okay.
So when I moved into the house 11, almost 12 years ago, I started to build that soil with manure.
Spring,
summer, fall. Mm-hmm. So I was building the structure. And now I have the most wonderful, growing medium.
Right. Well, and beautiful. And I love the style of your designing, because I love that English. It's, what do you call it, chaos with order, or what is the expression?
Organized chaos.
Organized chaos, that's what it is.
Right,
yeah, I mean, somehow it all comes together, but it doesn't look too planned.
Exactly.
Yeah.
But yet there are drifts, of certainly with the, I like to do a mixed border. So that year-round there's some interest there, whether it's a small deciduous shrub or a flowering tree or some evergreens in there too, and the ornamental grasses, mm-hmm. so that in the winter you don't just have stubs, cut stubs right. around. Although I must admit, I will say this, I don't cut down my perennials in the fall. I leave them up because number one, you've got the seed heads for the birds. Mm-hmm. And I also enjoy, you know, the subtle colors of fall. It mixes with the subtle, more somber colors of winter, mm-hmm. which are, you know, the grays, the browns, the soft greens, and the yellows, you know, that kind of thing. So I leave them up. There's no reason to cut them down.
Okay.
And, of course, you leave your grasses up until, ornamental grasses up until the end of March. And they look lovely with icicles on.
They do.
They look, really lovely.
Another thing that you're a big fan of, which is, I think, part of your program this year, is trying to get people back to vegetable gardening, which I am, I swear this year I'm going to have a vegetable garden. I had one years ago, and then I had kids, and I couldn't keep up with taking care of it. And now this year, last year we got a dog. This year is going to be the year of the vegetable garden. So what is your advice? Like, what for a family, how big, what's manageable, what's not?
Well, I'm really thrilled, love, that you said you're going to try a vegetable garden
again. I'm going to do it.
Well, also, in my company, we're going to be installing vegetable gardens folks, too.
Oh,
yes.
Great. You know, it is an overwhelming task if you're starting from getting your plot even in the
ground.
Yeah,
but it doesn't have to be, you know.
Okay.
Again, I mean, it would be if you had to do it all yourself, and I'm hoping that you can get hubby to help you,
I'm on a campaign.
All right, if you like, I'll come over.
Okay, come on, do something, right?
Because just think how, you know, the fruit and vegetables you get in the store. When was the last time it really tasted like a real tomato, you know, or a real lovely piece of fruit? And how long has that stuff been languishing on a truck? How many miles has that truck come? And never mind the carbon footprint that it's making.
The environmental impact.
Right. And the chemicals that have been sprayed on the fruit, which has taken away a lot of the taste, and also those chemicals you're ingesting into your body, which can cause all kinds of problems.
Right.
You know, I think, as you heard at the lecture you attended, you know, it's been found by the Harvard School Department of Public Health, followed by a Mayo Clinic report, that people exposed to herbicides and pesticides outdoors for any length of time have a higher chance of getting Parkinson's, a 70% higher chance.
Wow.
And of course, herbicides and pesticides, the link to cancer in dogs and cats has been very much been proved. So definitely, yes, vegetable garden, 16 by 24 would feed a family of four.
Wow.
Yeah, decent size,
you
know. If you're doing it in lawn, which I think you might be doing, if you can persuade hubby, it would be nice if you, and I don't do rows when it to do with vegetable garden. I do beds, you know. You get a much higher yield in beds.
So you do the raised beds.
You can do, raised beds, which would mean, well, with nice cedar, around them, and have them about 2 feet off the ground.
Okay.
Or you can have them at ground level. It actually is much easier to harvest and to weed and to take care of if the beds are raised. So you would have the raised beds, and if you're doing it in lawn, just leave the paths between your beds, say you would have four beds, leave the paths with sod on them. So that those are walking paths.
Now, do you put a gate? Some pictures again that we're going to put in. That even if you are putting it in the middle of your yard, they can be beautiful. And you do recommend doing some sort of a gate, whether it's a picket fence, which is what the picture has, or if it's just, you know, good old-fashioned chicken wire or something like that.
Well, I would suggest, because, you know, we have a lot of deer problems, don't we?
Yes.
If you're the pictures that you saw, they didn't have a deer problem in those two, which was unusual for Connecticut. But otherwise, you would have a tall fence.
Tall, okay.
You know, meaning like 5-6 feet.
Okay, so quite tall.
Yeah, quite tall, and with at least a 4-foot-wide gate, so that you could get the lawnmower in there to mow the paths between the beds.
So have the fencing far enough away so that you can move around in there. And tall enough.
Oh, absolutely.
To keep the deer and whatever else.
Right, and so that you wouldn't have grass growing up against the fence, you would have narrow beds along inside the fence where you could have your, you know, a lovely lot of sunflowers. Mm-hmm. And cucumbers, you know, growing up, and squash and all of that kind of thing, growing up the fence or up a trellis against the fence, too.
Right.
These beds that had been under grass, you'd need to go in and rototill, because mm-hmm. that earth would really be packed down. So okay. you'd go in, you'd rototill, and then you would add lots and lots of manure. Mm-hmm. You know, that good stuff.
We now know manure is our friend.
That's it, yeah. That marvelous stuff, yeah. As I say. I don't have any shares in any company. I don't know. But anyway, so lots and lots of manure. And I would imagine that a lot of folks, too, rather than starting from seed, you know, this first time, mm-hmm. they would be buying plants, you know.
Yeah, the little starter, seedlings, or, yeah.
Yes, the starter plants.
Yeah, right.
And, you know, you can, the thing to do, too, is try and find in your area mm-hmm. A place that is selling organic plants, if mm-hmm. you can.
I don't think that's true. At least in West Hartford, I think it's most garden centers have an organic selection of seedlings. Yeah, I don't think that's too.
That's wonderful. That's great, because then you're not adding, you know, fuel to the fire, so to speak.
Right.
And the thing to do, too, is plant the plants very close together so they touch, because then what you're doing is it's like a natural mulch.
Okay.
You know, you're preventing a lot of the weeds coming up, and you're also keeping the moisture in.
Okay.
You also have to make sure, though, that you've got a good source of water, you know, down for that garden. Now, we will be putting in soaker hoses in, you know, all of the mm-hmm. all of the beds down there, which is what we have in, you know, in all of the other borders that we do.
Right, to make sure they're watered.
But it can be a very inexpensive thing to do. You know, you have the soaker hoses, which can be attached to a spigot mm-hmm. at the house on a timer, you know, so that you keep it, you know, keep it nicely watered.
So we are, unfortunately, again, we're running out of time, but you do have this lovely website that has so much information.
Right, right.
And that is www.
It's theenglishlady.com/blog.
Slash blog.
To do with wonderful articles, timely garden tips, mm-hmm. and as well as the... you know, the eco shop and our eco mm-hmm. gardens and my blog that I do on WRCH. Uh-huh. So
yes, and
plenty,
people can tune in to WRCH
of
Thursdays,
also, if I didn't answer some questions today mm-hmm. for folks, they can email me, maureen@theenglishlady.com.
Okay.
And I'd be very happy to help them out.
To answer some questions.
Yes.
That's great. That's great. I always seem to run out of time, and I'm so interested in all of these the topics, but... We have the basics of how to get your vegetable garden started. And
if
you haven't learned anything, the one thing is manure.
Exactly.
It's aged manure.
That's it. The soil. Build it.
Build up
that's
your soil.
Sure.
That's great. Thank you so much,
it's
Maureen.
It's a pleasure. I had a lovely time.
Great. You've been watching Life in Style with Sarah. I'm Sarah Connor. Thank you so much for tuning in. And if you want more information about organic gardening and all of the terrific things that Maureen and the English Lady are doing in the Connecticut area, you can tune into her website, www.theenglishlady/blog, to find out more. Thanks and good night.